Is that right? Okay, great. It's my great pleasure to introduce to you, well, he's already introduced to you, but to reintroduce to you our fearless leader, Dan Geschwind. Dan Geschwind is a world leader in the genetics of autism, and he's been the leader, the director of our Center for Autism Research and Treatment for, gosh, how many years now, Dan? I can't remember. And he has an MD, PhD, and he's a full professor here and an endowed chair. He really is one of the top scientists in the world, and he is probably the most creative and innovative scientist I have ever met. So it's a great honor to have him here. Please welcome Dr. Daniel Geschwind.
I don't know what to say. That's a very kind introduction. I didn't pay her. And I've never heard her say that before. I've never heard anybody say that before, so I'm not sure it's true. But again, what I'm going to talk about a tough subject today, genetics for many people because they it's kind of a complex. It's even complex for us who study autism. So I will take questions during my talk, but I want them to be questions of clarification. Like, did what I say make sense? Like, I don't understand that term. If I use terms, we'll save the major questions for the end. I'm going to try to finish in about 30 minutes, so there's plenty of time to have a dialogue. But we'll see, I often get carried away. Here's the idea. Genetics is nothing magic. We are all a kind of, we're a composite of our genetics plus the environment. And the environment, from a geneticist standpoint, doesn't mean toxins, it just means everything else in the environment. Normal, the stuff we're usually exposed to, and stuff that maybe we shouldn't be exposed to. But, and so the idea here, though, is because genetics is a kind of hard quantitative science, and because if you identify a genetic etiology, let's say a gene that causes a disorder, you have a place to start to understand how the disorder would kind of unravel brain development. So I hope that makes sense, and I'm going to go into that in more detail, but I really want to clear. So I'm going to first give an introduction of, why genetics and autism, what genes have been identified and what that tells us, what these genes mean for clinical practice and treatment. And this is a slightly old slide. I used to do this, but I always just put up as much disclosure as I can. I'm no longer this year working for them, but within the last, let's say, 18 months. This is a company that was trying to develop blood biomarkers for early diagnosis of autism. And actually, I was quite negative about the original findings. I was a kind of, and it turned out to be somewhat negative. It was just too good to be true in a way. And so it really tells us, I mean, one of the things it tells us is that this is not an easy road. And the story I'm going to tell you is fraught with complexity. So please bear with me. But I do want to say something else. When I think back, I got involved in autism through advocates of friends who started Cure Autism Now. And I was a neurologist studying brain development, not working in autism. And at that point, when we started one of the gene banks that I work with called Agree with Cure Autism Now Foundation, almost now, it just seems, it's just remarkable, about 16 or 17 years ago, even a dozen years ago, if I had asked myself how many genes would I think we would find in 10 years, I might have said, maybe we'll find one or two. That was the hope, that maybe in my career, and I'm hopefully just not even halfway through career, I figured the career would be finding genes. But here we are at a point in 2016, what I'm going to tell you is that there are over 100 genes identified. And so there's been unbelievable progress in the last 5 years. And what that does is it just opens up amazing hope. But it's not hope, it's not random, we can't be overly kind of naive about the challenge of moving from a genetic finding to kind of a therapy. But I think it gives us a lot of hope. So first, I'm going to tell you that autism has a genetic origin, at least in part. Twin studies show a heritability average of about 70%. Very recent large-scale studies in Sweden show a little bit less, about 55%. But there's a wide range. The studies in the U.S. show between 70 and 90%. And so I'm very comfortable saying between like 55 and 75%, somewhere in there. Maybe 60%, 70%. It's just an estimate. Family studies. So now not looking at twins, because there could be things in twins that increase the risk for autism, so you also want to look in families. And you can look at the degree of relatedness. So if you're a sibling, you're a first-degree relative. If you're a first cousin, second cousin. What's the risk depending on relatedness? And so the risk to a sibling ranges from 15 to 25 times the population. Let's just call it 20-fold. And so that's pretty remarkable. So those two pieces of evidence are pretty conclusive. Of course, we've been finding genes, so that's even a better evidence. So many genetic syndromes or known chromosomal disorders are associated with autism. Dozens of rare genetic syndromes or mutations have been identified now. So there are multiple lines of evidence. And again, this gives us a place to start to understand the biology, what we call the neurobiology of autism, and to then begin to understand how we can alter that. Because we have to believe that it's environmentally alterable. That's the notion. What is a drug? What is a therapy? It's the environment acting on the system, us, to change something. And so the nervous system is malleable, and you'll hear more about this throughout the day, whether I'm talking about a pharmacologic therapy or a behavioral or cognitive therapy. But a phenotype, that is anything you can measure, is the sum of the genotype plus the environment. These are two teddy bears from my colleague Nelson Frymer, who's a psychiatric geneticist, given one to each of his boys. And I know everybody in CART has seen this before, but I just love this slide so much because one of them was loved and used and handled, and the other one was left in the closet. And sometimes you think otherwise, that one was taken care of, but no, the one that was loved is the one that's a little worn down. The point is that these two teddy bears were born with the same DNA, just different environment. So again, please don't get the idea that I'm a purist about the genetics. The genetics is just a tool to identify causal factors, and then we can understand how during brain development this syndrome might evolve. So let me just show a little bit of that. Genes interact with the environment during fetal brain development, leading to cerebral structure. It's a dynamic structure. We have gross anatomy, microscopic things, chemical, molecular. It's not just a structure that you see. It's moving, it's changing, it's plastic as we learn. And again, cognitive function or learning or behavior has a feedback on this structure as well. So you can imagine that the brain that we see in a 10-year-old, let's say, who has an autism spectrum disorder, is going to be the consequence of the genetic or environmental causes altering cerebral structure, altering behavior, but then there's a feedback as well as the child develops over different stages. They may, the brain is going to be different, not just because of the causal, but because of their difference in the way that they also interact with the environment their brain does. And again, the idea is that if we can identify genes, we can figure out what happens in between there during development to alter cerebral structure and function, leading to the condition. That's the notion. Now we also have to think, and again, now we're going to start getting into some biology of different levels of understanding. So if I start with the genes here, all the way on the left, and all the way at the bottom is autism, this broad spectrum. Remember, autism is not defined by etiology. It's defined by observation and history. So you have social dysfunction and repetitive restrictive behavior, and then the diagnosis can be modified by language disorder, motor dysfunction, sensory disturbance, etc. But the core being social and repetitive restrictive behavior at this point in the newest incarnation of DSM-5. So I put up six monogenic conditions or major gene mutations that can lead to autism. And they're mostly syndromes. And then what I show there is the different levels at which they might converge. So brain regions and circuits going back to molecular pathways. So again, think about cancer. A lot of the cancer drugs that are now coming out target a specific molecular pathway or mutation. That's what we're talking about. Or biological pathways. So the cancer idea would be the cells proliferate and invade. So it would be something that would block the invasion of the cells or proliferation. That's a biological pathway. In the brain, that would be something like making connections, making synapses, signaling. At the molecular level, it would be like affecting that specific mutation and how that's interacting with the brain. All the way to the right, we have brain regions and circuits. And at some level, since behavior emanates from brain structure, the brain is the organ from which all of our cognition and behavior comes, that, and different regions of the brain subserve different cognitive and behavioral functions. I have a part of my brain that's involved in vision, and there are others in memory. And social cognition is very complicated and involves a lot of interaction of different brain regions, but it's not the entire brain. And so there are regions, especially in the frontal cortex, frontal striatal cortex, frontal temporal, frontal parietal, and temporal parietal connections that have to be involved in social behavior. So at some level, we could say a priori that autism has to involve convergence at the level of brain regions and circuits that subserve social behavior. And why is this important? From a therapeutic standpoint, just think for a second. Let's think into the future when we have devices that can modify brain function, electrical activity or stuff like that. It could be that you could modify the functioning of those circuits using external devices or implanted devices or other things. Similar to Parkinson's disease right now, there's deep brain stimulation and there are actually implantable devices that are implanted into the brain. And you could, I'm not saying that that's ready for autism, but I'm saying that we just have to think that way, so it's possible that we can act on circuits. But what I'm going to talk about, and where I think the genetics leads us, is to start thinking about molecular and biological pathways. It starts giving us a mechanistic understanding of what happens when. And so the idea here is that rather than using a unidimensional approach, we're using what's called a systems biology approach, where we integrate from genetics through all these other levels. So we find genes, we can make mutations in animals and study them, again, in an animal model or in an in vitro model, like a stem cell model. We can study the mechanism, how the connections are made, how that leads to behavioral changes, etc. But we also study postmortem tissue. It's rare, but we find it. And then we can ask, how does the animal model look like postmortem tissue, etc. So there's kind of a cycle of research that's going on. But at the same time, we're trying to look at this not from one gene at a time. I told you there are now over 100 genes identified. And in most people, in most cases, it's unlikely to be a single gene cause. It's likely to be a combination of genes, and I'll get into that in a second. So again, we identify genes, we study the effects of those in human patients, in mouse models, and in primary neurons in a dish, kind of autism in a dish. So just to back off from that, before we get into what I think is some really exciting stuff, let's talk about the implications of knowing the genetic causes of a disorder. And I call it a disease, and I should hit myself, because autism is not a disease, it's a syndrome. But autism itself is a syndrome. That is, it's not defined by some etiology. It's not tuberculosis. It's dysfunction in behavior and has many etiologies. So it's a disorder or a syndrome. But knowing the genetic basis of a disorder has significant implications. So you know about Down syndrome. Down syndrome is genetic, but it's not inherited. So there's that type of risk. We call those de novo mutations. If it is inherited, how is it inherited? Is it dominant? Is it recessive? And knowing the genetic basis of the disorder has significant implications for prevention. We might see gene-environment interactions. The mechanism of mutation could be preventable. And, of course, early diagnosis and intervention. And the hope is, if we think of this notion that you probably heard of precision medicine or precision health, for all of our healthcare, that if we have genome knowledge and other knowledge, we can begin to individualize therapies, and we can talk about a prognosis, not of a generic child with autism, but of a specific child with a specific liability set that could be a number of genes and their environment. And that's what the hope is for the future. So autism in the individual, I'm going to summarize this, and I'm going to go in to show you some of the data. There are multiple forms of mutations that have been identified. So we have rare Mendelian mutations. These are recessive or dominant mutations that are very rare, but they're probably sufficient to cause the autism. They're a major hit. And they often cause autism and intellectual disability. We also have rare mutations that have what we call low penetrance. That is, maybe only 10% of, like Fragile X, 20% of the people with Fragile X mutation have an autism spectrum disorder. Well, that's much higher than 20-fold the general population, but 80% don't. So the question is, are there other environmental genetic or epigenetic risk factors that fit into that puzzle in that patient? And then most causes of autism are multifactorial. So that means multiple genes, each with small effect size, that are percolating usually commonly in the population. We all will have copies of these genes. These are things that are present in more than 5% of the population in general. And it's kind of a combination of those with environmental factors, probably, that then leads to autism. So again, just to kind of show that, and here's like a kind of modern population human genetics lesson, maybe. If we think about mutations, I told you, effect size versus frequency in the population. So things that are very frequent in the population have very small effect sizes. Why? Because to be frequent, none of us probably here, very few, know our common ancestor. Like, if we went up to each other, oh yeah, remember, great, 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 great grandma that we had together. But the point is, we have common ancestors, thousands of years back. And the issue there is that, so evolution, natural selection, removes deleterious mutations from the population. So the things that we all have commonly, that we share with each other, more than 5%, generally have low effect sizes. But they could add up together to cause a specific disorder. And so the very frequent things have very small, they're on the small effect size end here. So you have high frequency, low effect size, very high effect size are rare mutations. Because if a parent had one, it's unlikely they're going to reproduce because it has a large effect size. It gets weeded out, and if they do, it's not going to last too many generations. So again, in autism, if we look at a circle like a pie chart, about half of it, we don't know where it comes from genetically. But about half comes from this common genetic variation, and about another 10 or 20% from the rare forms of autism. And that's something we've just been learning with genome sequencing. So what this tells us is that there's a part of autism, and I'm going to go into this in a second, that is like Down syndrome. It's genetic, but not inherited from the parents. And we think that's somewhere around 20-25%. Then there's about 60-70% that's heritable. And then there may be pure environmental causes as well. For example, we know that certain types of, birth history retrospectively, if there was perinatal complications and hypoxia, leads to increase in cerebral palsy and epilepsy as well as autism. I'm just going to skip over this next slide for time because I'm not going to get too technical. But here's something that you're all going to be hearing about as clinicians and parents. So it turns out that there, let's think of two major forms of mutation. One is a chromosomal disorder like Down syndrome where you have an extra chromosome or loss of chromosome. What we found as our techniques got better, that it's not, we don't just gain and lose whole chromosomes. That small pieces, about 1,000 base pairs at a time, called copy number variation, 4% of our genome is copy number variant. That is that each of us, we don't have a full extra loss or gain of chromosome, but we do have about 4% of our genome. We only have one copy. We thought we had two, one from mom, one from dad, but it's deleted a little bit there, or we have an extra copy. And so that's shown here. If you think of the genome as an alphabet, kind of, just like a set of letters strung on a strand of DNA, it could be inverted, it could be deleted, or it could be duplicated. 4% of our genome. Most of that is benign, doesn't really cause disease. But sometimes when it's large enough, and especially de novo or new events, like Down syndrome, where the parents don't have it, but it's in the child, those are not benign. And so visible chromosomal abnormalities are not really part of autism, but these submicroscopic, discovered by this new technology called microarray, which can look at very high resolution. So again, a human cell, we get 23 from mother, 23 from father. I've just shown in red there a part that's possibly deleted. And the microarray can detect that. Here's a duplication on 15q11, q13. This is probably accounts for about, between 0.5 and 1% of autism. This is often de novo, but it can be inherited from a neurotypical mother. But now that we can detect these, we've discovered more and more disorders. So again, they're called copy number variants. And the reason this is important to know is because as you're talking with physicians or geneticists or hearing, you're going to hear this term because it turns out that they're present, I'll just go through this quickly, large de novo, like Down syndrome type things that aren't present in the parents but are seen in the child, are present in at least 6% of kids with autism. So it's a diagnostic test now. In other words, if you can diagnose between 5 and 10% of kids with any disorder, it's clinically indicated to do this clinical microarray test. So this has changed clinical practice. Why is it important? Well, imagine for genetic counseling, if I can identify, well, number one, it ends the diagnostic odyssey. You now know what the cause is. Two, if it's a de novo event, that means it's not coming from the parent, most likely, and it changes the risk to future offspring. So they don't have the 10 or 20% risk. They're more closer to the population risk because this is a non-inherited but genetic event. Does that make sense? Like Down syndrome. You have one child with Down syndrome. The next two don't necessarily have an increased risk. They have a risk that's related to the mother's age, general population issues. So because of this, we now have all these disorders, and I just list them there just to show you. Many of them don't have people's names anymore because they're just regions of the genome that we've identified a gain or loss of a number of genes. And these are things, if you look in column 3 and column 4, those are really where the money is. None of these account for more than 1% of autism. So even the most frequent, like 15q or fragile X, is a little bit less than 1%. And the proportion with autism varies. So these aren't necessarily specific to autism, but they increase the risk dramatically. If you have a 50% risk of having autism with one of these factors, you have a 50 times risk over the general population. So it's almost certain that that's the causal event. Does that make sense? So very heterogeneous. About 10 to 20% of causes we can find genetic causes in. So what we do is we do clinical microarray. If it's a boy, we do fragile X testing. And then if that's negative, we do clinical exome sequencing. Now, there are some other very rare syndromes where if a really experienced medical geneticist sees the kid, they may send another specific test. But in general, that's the way that we would approach this. And what's happened remarkably is since this time, in 2009, when this book chapter was published, these are all copy number variation. There's been this dramatic drop in the cost of sequencing genomes, and you probably read this in the newspaper. So it used to be that sequencing a genome cost $1 million just, you know, under 10 years ago, and now it's under $2,000 actually to do this. And you can see Moore's Law, which is the rapid shrinkage of the integrated circuit size. So Gordon Moore predicted that every 18 months there'd be a doubling of the density of components on integrated circuits, on chips. And that's shown there. That's an exponential decline. And you can see the super exponential decline because of the introduction of disruptive sequencing technology in the mid-2000s. So I think we're going to approach a $100 or $200 genome. And so what's going to happen in the future is everybody's going to have their genome done. It's going to be part of your medical record, and it's going to lead us to be able to do a lot better with your specific care. We're a little off from that, but it's not that far. So we've applied these technologies, we and other colleagues, to autism and have found a lot of genes. And so in 2012, the first studies were identified. And again, here the story is the same as with the microarray. There's no common gene. It's like a collection of rare mutations, rare disorders that we're finding. Based on these studies, we estimate more than 500 genes are going to be found, maybe even 1,000. We also see a strong effect of paternal age. That is, especially when fathers start getting into their 50s, the risk of having a child with autism or one of these mutations goes up about 2 or 3-fold. So it's just 2 or 3-fold. It's not like an enormous risk, but it's a significant risk. Every 10 years, it's about a 30 or 40% increase. And just to show this here, the other thing, you know, in this one paper from Evan Eichler's group, it shows the 4-to-1 that these events that occurred, they're de novo, so they're not in the parent's germline, they're in the egg or sperm, they're in the germ, they're not in their somatic cells, they're in their germ cells. It's 4-to-1, much more likely to come from on the dad, again, these sperm mutations. And that has to do with the fact that the eggs are made, you know, very, very early in women, and they're there for life, whereas the sperm are always being generated. And as we get older, we just get worse at repairing everything, from an ankle sprain to DNA, and that's what's happening. And that's just showing the number of de novo coding mutations in terms of paternal age. So just to summarize now, we know there are these de novo not inherited mutations that are kind of dominant. They act dominantly. You only need one mutation. Could be on the maternal or paternal allele, but mostly 4-to-1 on the paternal. That probably accounts for 20% of autism now. And these are some of the genes, but all of them are really rare syndromes. Autosomal recessive is even rarer, but if you have an area of consanguinity, first cousins marrying second cousins, this is increased. In fact, that gene, CNTNAP2, which I'm going to talk about right at the end, is a gene that most of us don't have to worry about at all. But if you live in the Amish country, if you're Amish, it causes the most common neurodevelopmental disorder in the Amish, which is a form of autism. But it's recessive. Both parents have to be carrying it. You have to have both mutations on both alleles, so it's not acting dominantly. And that's shown there, right, with the stars. And again, autosomal dominant, kind of inherited non-de novo. There are a bunch of other genes. X-linked is very rare. Used to be thought, well, there's this 4-to-1 ratio of males to females. Maybe it's X-linked. It's the X chromosome, because males only have one copy and females have two. Turns out there's some of that going on, but it does not account for the male risk. And then, of course, there's what I call additive risk. This is a genetic term. But what additive risk means is the common variation that we all carry kind of adds up in somebody to increase their risk. So it's a kind of combination of many factors. Could be actually dozens or hundreds in a given individual. We actually don't know. But again, just to hammer this point in, genetic testing can currently identify about 20% of mutations contributing to autism. So it's indicated clinically. So if you have patients, especially if they have any intellectual disability or language delay or seizures, the yield in that, or other physical abnormalities, cardiac dysfunction, hypotonia, those kind of kids should be sent, we do clinical exome sequencing here. You could, refer them to medical genetics and they would get their testing done. But unfortunately this just hasn't gotten out into the community the way it should. And a lot of that is, of course, pushback from insurers. On the other hand, what they're beginning to realize is that once this is done, it saves like tens of thousands of dollars of alternative testing. So it actually, we think that this kind of testing is going to save a lot of angst, right, a lot of time going to doctors trying to figure out what's going on, as well as a lot of money in the healthcare system. So this is clinical microarray, fragile X's first line, followed by whole exome sequencing. So our challenge, and I'm going to end with a few vignettes kind of, is that advances in genetics and genomics have identified many genes. I told you more than 100. These genes provide targets, but they highlight this extraordinary heterogeneity. Am I going to have to treat 500 distinct disorders and understand them? Or will there be convergence on specific biological pathways? Somewhat similar to it's kind of cancers in an intermediate area where, there's specific targeted therapy for specific pathways. So one thing we can ask is, if we take these 100 genes that have been identified pretty significantly in autism, do they act in a particular brain region or at a particular time during development in a particular cell or circuit? So we can ask that now. And so this is just a map, time map of human brain development from embryonic through birth and postnatal and down below what's going on biologically. So the neurons in the brain are born for the cerebral cortex starting at about 7 or 8 weeks gestation, so around 45 days. They're born and then they migrate up to the cerebral cortex. And that migration goes on for months. Then they start growing elaboration, making connections, which are called synapses. And then myelination and development and further development can go on into the second and third decade. So where do autism genes act? Well, it turns out when we look, they essentially act there. The vast majority of them that have been identified, it's almost, it's entirely conclusive, are acting at the mid-fetal stage. So before birth, at about 16 to 20 weeks gestation, during the peak of neurogenesis, neuronal migration, the building of the cerebral cortex. And just to show this, you know, if you look at age on the bottom, red being birth, we've shown that if we look at these genes that are mutated in autism, that they show various trajectories. There are two major trajectories identified. Let me see if I can. One of them is very, very early, even right during neurogenesis, and then these genes go down. And the other is as neurons are born. These are the synaptic genes, the things that are involved in neuronal function. But they really, they kind of are all going on about 16 weeks. You can see they kind of cross each other here. So the kind of core activity is happening right during the middle of fetal life. And the other thing we find is that the layers 2 and 3 of the cerebral cortex are particularly enriched in mutations. It's not specific. And why is that important? Those are the regions that connect the different regions from front to back and across the corpus callosum, which connects the two hemispheres. So we kind of begin to think of this as a disconnectivity syndrome based on the genetics, which is super interesting because I'm hoping you're going to hear about the imaging, about a lot of disconnectivity. So the imaging work shows some disconnectivity or disruption in networks, and the genetics suggests that as well. So then how do we move from this? I don't think we're going to be able to target a fetal brain, for therapy. At least that's not on the horizon. But if we can understand what these mutations do to brain development and how they set up circuits, that's where I think we're going to be able to intervene. So when we look at the various genes that are implicated, they're involved in several processes. One of them is activity-dependent protein synthesis, which are proteins that are made based on essentially learning. And so a lot of this is related to neuronal activity. So we can modulate the excitation or inhibition that goes on in the brain. Brain is essentially a chemical, electrical machine. Yeah?
So does that mean once autistic, always autistic, based on these studies? Or can you...
No, not at all. It's just, remember, these are just risk things that happen. There'll even be people that will find out there, I'm sure, with these major gene mutations in which 95% of people who have them get autism. Who are neurotypical, right? So that's the kind of far example. But so these are huge risk factors that cause an abnormality in brain development, but our hope is with therapy, we can modulate things. And some of this may also be a delay in development or alteration that then eventually can be compensated for. So then if you look at the behavior, you don't see it using alternative strategies. So we've been using mouse, now making these mutations. We've been using human neural progenitors. We've been studying brain. And the idea is to use all of this information to begin to develop therapeutics. So one of the ways is, again, I mentioned these neurons in a dish. We can take skin cells from a patient now, or anybody, and we can grow, we can make them into stem cells. That is, they become pluripotent. Take a skin cell, a fibroblast. We reprogram it to become a stem cell. From that point on, it can become any cell in the body, a heart cell, a brain cell, doesn't matter. We can program it to make it a neuron, and then we can study it in a dish. And this technology won Yamanaka the Nobel Prize a few years ago because it's revolutionizing biomedicine. And so we've used these with a collaborator at Stanford, Ricardo Dolmetsch and Sergio Pasca, in several studies. This is just one of them, where we actually use the neurons grown from patients with Timothy syndrome, a really rare form of cardiac disorder with about 70% of the kids with autism, and use it to screen for drugs and find something that reverses it in a dish. So again, this gets back to this issue here where we can begin to understand the implications for prevention or even treatment if we can use these mutations to get a mechanistic understanding. So in the last minute or so, I'm going to show you that people have made mouse models now, taking these mutations, doing genetic engineering in a mouse. We use the mouse because it's easy to engineer. There's a lot of it's just a technology issue. And it's a mammal that has a lot of parallels to human. We have to be careful because a mouse is not a small human. And that's why it's important to use the stem cells in a dish to go back and forth between human and mouse. And some of the imaging studies as well are really critical. But now we can do functional magnetic resonance imaging that you're going to see in mice. We can do a lot of the same things that we're doing in humans and mice, and so we can translate across this. That's the hope. What's really been remarkable to me, because I took an evolutionary perspective where I originally thought, you know, mouse, I'm going to put a mutation in the mouse that causes the epilepsy and autism syndrome by CNTNAP2 in the Amish. We're going to study that mutation. And I didn't think the mouse would have behavioral differences, but we can use the mouse to dissect the biochemical mechanism. But it turns out that these models that I'm showing here on the left, these are major gene forms of autism or other developmental disorders, all parallel many aspects, not all, of the human disorders quite remarkably. And so that's been kind of amazing to me. I don't think they all will, but even if half of them show social dysfunction or repetitive behaviors or other learning difficulties, we can probably use them to study. So we showed that the absence of this gene, just like in the Amish, causes epilepsy. We find neuronal migration problems, again, fitting back to that fetal brain development, and core autism-related deficits, including social dysfunction. And we did a drug screen. Olga Penagarincano, who is now running her own laboratory in Spain, in Bilbao, she pioneered these studies. And we took the mice, now that we have an autism model, and we screened about 10 drugs, she did, on those mice, and asked the question, do any of them reverse the social behavior? And it turned out that oxytocin did. And I'm just going to show that to you here. These are both knockout cages, and one has gotten oxytocin and the other one hasn't. And and just watch how the mice interact. So again, one of the issues, the critical issue, is going to be the timing of this treatment. How, you know, so we have to use these mice and other studies in humans and primates to understand how often we have to give the treatment. Will it work in everybody? No, it won't work in everybody. When we give this drug to a wild-type mouse, it has no changes in behavior. It's with this particular knockout. So some forms of autism may have an oxytocin deficit, and therefore giving oxytocin could be helpful. That's just the idea. I think it's critical to realize that also in many of these neurodevelopmental disorders, even if the major deficit occurs during fetal life, Fragile X, tuberous sclerosis, Rett, they can be, many of the behavioral deficits have been shown in mouse to be reversed in adulthood. So this represents a paradigm shift. Should these findings generalize to humans, genetically identified pathway therapeutics would become the most important area of future treatment. This is in 2009. Actually, one of my students had this in her thesis talk. I'd forgotten I had said this, so I've like resurrected this slide to show how prescient I was. No, that's a joke. Hopefully you can. So again, getting back, so what are these pathways? Well, one of the pathways that's popping up is this protein translation. I'm sorry about that screw up there. The brown genes are all genes that are mutated in various monogenic conditions that are associated with autism. So that means, and there are drugs that actually affect these pathways and can be tested. Again, when you learn, new proteins are synthesized at your synapses. And so this is a critical piece. Wnt signaling, which is involved in development, it's involved in everything, really. But there are drugs that inhibit this. In fact, lithium, the drug that's used at bipolar, inhibits GSK3 beta, that linchpin there. And synaptic signaling, you know, so we need to develop new classes of drugs that affect synaptic function and this is a very active area of investigation to really understand what exactly, is it hyperexcitability in some cases, is it specific neural pathways, not enough inhibition. We're almost at a point with the mouse models in many cases where we're beginning to understand exactly what the mechanism might be, and that's going to give us some targeting hope. But again, I mentioned, you know, the functional connectivity issues or the certain tracks. It may be that in some cases we're actually able to intervene, you know, using new novel technologies, implantable devices, et cetera. Or again, as I mentioned, the balance of excitation inhibition. And this remains to be seen, but these are all new hopeful areas that just 10 years ago were not possible. So I want to leave you with this from Paul Kalanithi. You probably, I don't know if you've read, he's written his book is number one on the bestseller list. An extraordinary guy. He was a neurosurgeon who died at age 37. He was 36 at this point. He had a very rare form, well, not a rare, but rare to have at this age, lung cancer. And his book is called When Breath Becomes Air, and it's an extraordinary book. He's an amazing writer, and it takes a terrible situation and really gives you hope. But I think he really states it well here. This was from a New York Times editorial before he died. For young people like me, I'm 36, given a diagnosis of cancer, there aren't many words. And then my health began to improve thanks to a pill that targets a specific genetic mutation. He probably gained about a year of life. I mean, it's not a magic bullet that led him to a full cure. Sometimes it is. In his case, it wasn't. And that probably has to do with heterogeneity of the tumor. In other words, this was targeting part of the tumor, but not the whole thing. But it's a drop of hope. And so the notion is, with this idea of genetics, one of the hopes is that we can, instead of treating people, I mean, autism is not a single disorder. Its etiology is manifold. And therefore, if we begin to treat individuals across the spectrum as the individual that they are, the genetics and also measuring environment and sleep and other things, you put all that together, you can begin to come up with a kind of more rational, targeted, precision treatment for those patients. And that's the hope throughout biomedicine, and it's my hope in neurodevelopmental disorders and autism. So while autism risk is largely genetic, its etiology is multifactorial and very heterogeneous. Rare genetic variants contribute to at least 10% of cases and may explain more. Genetic testing is warranted now clinically. Exome sequencing is a clinical test in autism, and soon whole genome sequencing will be a clinical test. I hope I've just given you a kind of a glimpse at how genetics might provide a route to development of new therapies, and that there are now dozens of animal models and cell models going on. In fact, about 6 years ago, most major pharmaceutical companies exited drug development and neuroscience for all brain disorders because of the difficulty. And it's because of identification of mutations and genetic findings and Alzheimer's and other disorders that and autism that they're now getting back in, because they see this similar to cancer as something that they can actually target. It gives you something to hold on to. So I'm, again, you have to be optimistic in this business. I am very optimistic, but I think there's reason to be optimistic because the pace has been remarkable. I have to thank all the people in the Geschwind lab. This is just a few pictures showing them in the 1 minute of happiness they have during the day. The rest of the time, they're hunched over the bench, working hard in the computer. I don't have time to thank them all, but you can, you know, we have a remarkable, unbelievably dedicated group of undergraduates, but, you know, Ph.D. students, postdoctoral fellows, and research scientists who are focused on this. So thanks for your attention.